Hello, everyone. This is Starik Pollock, founder and managing editor for the Rusyn Literature Society. Today, I have Vladimir Skala on. He is a recent guest author. He published this wonderful piece called Between the Millstones. From my perspective, I like to think of it as kind of a somewhat of a kind of general overview of Rusyn history with some of his own opinions or kind of theories about things kind of interwoven throughout that. So thanks for coming on, Vladimir. And if you don't mind, just give us a little bit of an introduction.
Thank you for having me, Starik. So I've originally, I'm from Medziloborce. That's my hometown. And that's where I spent the first 13 years of my life. And most of my family come from a little bit further north, in the village of Chertivne, which has been a site of quite a few important historical milestones and also important people connected to the village when it comes to Rusyn history. And after finishing primary school, my whole family moved to Chicago, where I spent another 12 years or so. And now I'm living and working in China.
So what prompted that move exactly to go to China?
I guess curiosity. I finished my master's in applied linguistics, and a lot of my classmates, they had experience of teaching abroad, teaching in Korea, teaching in Japan. China was one of the destinations, so I decided to come to China.
I do want to ask you one question, actually, before we kind of get into the meat of the article. But do you think, in general, your experience in China has really changed your view of Rusyn issues, or perhaps the way to solve these, your kind of general perspective on politics, perhaps, as well?
I don't think so. It's changed my views on certain things. But I wouldn't say it's changed my views on Rusyn issues. Yeah, it's here the society is very much top down, and business is one of the outlets for people. So a lot of people are in business; they don't talk about politics, and so it's kind of also gotten me interested more in business, but not really about Rusyn issues and society and Rusyn politics.
Getting into the article, I think what's most interesting to me is why you wrote it in the first place. It is a wonderful work. It's quite lengthy. But what was your purpose of writing it? Because, of course, there's many avenues people can take to talking about Rusyn issues or things like that. That's not such a meaty piece.
Yeah, I've been teaching now for, well, let me see, 12, 13 years or so in total, around 12 years, let's say. And in my experience, the best way to learn something is to teach it. Yeah. And this article is an attempt for me to come to grips with this very complex history that we have, because you know, you have so many different things coming into our history, so many different actors, internal and external. So I wanted to understand better our history, and I just started writing out and researching and so forth. But that was one of the things. And another thing was the war in Ukraine. And once that started, I was, like most people, just in complete shock. And just the first week, I was just obsessing over the news. And at the same time, I started interacting with all kinds of different people, lots of Ukrainians too, and the Rusyn issue came up, and you know, some Ukrainians can get quite nasty
when it comes to Rusyn issues, very nationalistic, very chauvinistic. And in that way, that kind of prompted me that I need to do this. I need to have some productive result after one particularly nasty interaction. I thought, okay, I'm gonna write something. At first I started writing like an opinion piece, just something short. But then as I was getting deeper into it, I thought, okay, I need to research a little bit more here. I like to find out more. I still have a lot more questions than I initially started with. And there's still new things that I'm reading and finding out about. So those two motivations is to find out more, and also the war in Ukraine, those were the driving factors behind the piece.
It certainly seems as though from your writing that you still are holding out hope that there can be some type of a very democratic way in which Rusyns can be recognized and integrated into Ukrainian society. You kind of talk about at the end of the piece, the EU and being a candidate member and these other such things. I must admit, I'm much more pessimistic of this angle. I from my own personal experiences, and then also from going there, I just must say, I would like to kind of understand from your perspective. We'll just take the EU, integration first. I don't necessarily see why that would entail a shift in the relationship between them, and I'd like to understand your perspective on that.
Relationship, you mean like the culture within Ukraine?
I would say, well, I'd say there's two different things here. I'd say number one is that kind of Rusyn issue, yes. Number two, I would say the democratization of Ukrainian society, because I think that many people, especially in the West, you are certainly not someone who is knowledgeable about these things, but I think many people in the West kind of see Ukrainian society as this very freedom-loving place in comparison to Russia or somewhere like that. And I didn't see that at all. And everything I read does not indicate that. So I'm just interested in how you think these forces can change this very totalitarian society.
Well, I agree with you that it is not this freedom-loving place that the Western media portrays Ukraine to be. You go to Freedom House and to rank, the ranking of freedoms and democracy within countries, Ukraine still ranks pretty low, much higher than Russia, of course, which is sensible, but it's still not considered a working democracy. That is something I agree with you on, but European Union is just too tempting, too big of for whatever reasons. I'm sure that there's oligarchs within Ukraine that they're just thinking about how they could line their pockets in a similar ways that Orban has done in the past decade. I'm sure that there's different motivations for joining EU, but to do that, you have to play by certain rules. And so why I'm optimistic is if we can form key alliances, form key relationships with people within Brussels, politicians from Slovakia, politicians from Poland representing us, who understand our issues and will help resolve these problems, then I'm optimistic that it's going to happen. It's something that Ukraine will have to do. And that's part of the reason why I also started addressing this in the Slovak blogosphere. And I'm trying to make just a Slovak readership more knowledgeable about the Rusyn issues in Ukraine. I think that awareness is a big issue. People just don't know. Even Rusyns in Slovakia, most Rusyns are not going to know about the issues that Rusyns in Ukraine are facing. But we are the ones that need to start working out on this and change that. So in that way, I'm optimistic. Yeah, it can happen.
I think that's a good segue into another topic, in that I wasn't able to really get a feel for this, but how much of our current situation do you feel it is because of our historical incompetency in many regards, or do you feel as though many of these things that have happened to us over the last, say, 150 years have been things that even if we did have competent leaders in place, even if we did have a greater national identity, they would have still happened? That is one thing that did interest me, is that a lot of the times we talk about history of these things, and we talk about it in very neutral terms. For example, Zhatkovich, he's kind of glorified among American Rusyns too. And yet, if we look at him as a politician, he's kind of a failure in many regards. So I think that I'm just interested in that kind of balance between what your opinion is on that.
Yeah, in that way, Zhatkovich is kind of the typical, like a prototype Rusyn politician. In the way that it's kind of very inward looking, very kind of unable to network very well, to form key alliances, to leverage connections outside of the Rusyn realm and to help the Rusyn situation. I think that is a big issue for a lot of people involved in Rusyn activism, is just kind of being very comfortable working within that microcosm of Rusynness, of Rusyn issues, and not having much connections outside of it. That's what we need to do, is to bring in people who are not Rusyns, who are way out of the realm, attract them to the culture, to our struggles, to our things we're trying to do and accomplish, and to get things done. And to become basically more outward looking, to become more, bit of a cliche, to become more of a global citizens, you know. It's a bit of a cliche in this day and age, but yeah, not to be just, you know, looking down at your shoes, but looking out on the horizon and all the opportunities and connections that there are, instead of just being so obsessed with the small problems at hand. Well, small problems, relatively, you know.
Well, I think that's interesting how you say that, because I view the current intelligentsia of the Rusyns as very liberal globalists in nature for many of them. I mean, you kind of have two camps, is that you kind of have the diaspora Western activists who I can't find a single thing that they've accomplished lately worth a damn, frankly. And then you have the kind of local people who are certainly not that, but like you say, are very tuned into the local issues and don't really know how to project power or to get connections. To me, I like the idea of bringing people kind of outside in. I also just think that we need to actually build in a kind of upper crust of these kind of activists and people who actually understand how to get our interests accomplished. You know, I think that I kind of like to give an example to people of that. We would much rather protest for 5 years about having a Rusyn holiday rather than just getting some governor elected so that he can proclaim the Rusyn holiday. Like, it's this thing of, there's like this disconnect among Rusyns of that they don't even understand how to accomplish things. Like, they think going out and doing all these activities is somehow going to accomplish institutional change. Now, I'm all for people who love to do the festivals, who love to do all these different types of things, but I just see this very lacking element. And it doesn't even have to be like a Rusyn, right? It can be a Slovak from the Presov region who is very friendly with the Rusyn community, who then fights for our interests, you know? But people don't even think of that, as you said. Like, people don't make that connection. And so I'm kind of wondering, from your perspective, is how do you think an intelligentsia of Rusyns can be formed that perhaps are globally thinking, yet still look out for Rusyns as a people?
Yeah, we've already talked about this issue before when I contacted you, and I mentioned my ideas about education. And, you know, education is often, nowadays, it's very fashionable to dole it out as a panacea, something that's going to solve all the problems is education. And I'm not in that vein of thought. I don't think education on its own, but combined with other things, combined with, for instance, connecting educational institutions with other more famous educational institutions who of higher learning, like, for instance, with Oxford or Cambridge, to know about us, to know that if we have some talented students, they might have doors open in that institution and have more of that kind of leadership forming. So I do think education can be one of the answers of forming that kind of intelligentsia is not just education that's concerned about just preserving the Rusyn language, because if you look at a lot of activists today, they focus on this primary issue, is preserving the Rusyn language, and parents just don't see the value in that. They say, well, why do they need to know Rusyn? You know, it's just Slovak is okay, and then English. But if you have institutions which are perceived as very valuable, perceived as being connected to top institutions of higher learning around the world and bring a lot of value, they teach also, you know, they don't teach just Rusyn, but they teach other things, important things in STEM and science, technology, engineering and math, that can attract the parents. And also, it on its own, it creates.
Hey everyone, sorry about that. We just had a couple of connection issues. We're back here on Skype, so my apologies if the audio is not as good. I will do my best in post-production. So, anyways, Vladimir, do you remember what we left off on?
Yeah, we talked about building up Rusyn intelligentsia, what can be done differently. Mm-hmm. And I kind of segued into education a little bit, and talking about what can be done different in terms of Rusyn education. Let me just go a little bit further in the past and explain a couple of things about the Slovak system so that I can make my point a little bit more clear. I thought about a way to build an effective education system, and you got to look at the weaknesses of the current system right now. So when I graduated the Slovak education system, it was from primary school, it was still pretty much the inheritance of the communist system, which meant basically that it was kind of an elitist higher education, only
a few people actually went into college and got the degrees. And so what this meant is that schools had pretty good quality teachers. Now, if you look in a classroom and you look around, you look at the equipment, you know, it's pretty bare. But the person sitting behind the teacher's desk, those people were pretty good. And so based on that, the quality of education was quite good. When I graduated primary school and then started going to high school in US, I could see that right away. I mean, I was in some cases 4 grades ahead of everybody else when it came to maths and sciences. So quality of education was good. And over time, because universities opened, new universities opened, and now a lot more kids are getting degrees, it kind of diluted the quality of education across the board, not just in universities, because now you have worse teachers coming into the system and teaching. And so overall, the education quality in Slovakia has decreased. So that is the weakness that can be addressed. I mean, you know, every 4 years that there's a parliamentary election, there's promises that they'll do something about education, but they don't. So what we can do is not wait for the government to do something about it, but build good quality education with international connections, with people from and know-how from abroad, from Finland or from Singapore or from other places, who would be willing to come and help us to do this. So addressing the weaknesses within the system and building up a system which can in some ways return or may even surpass the quality of education from the past. By doing that, we can attract parents to want to enroll their children in this education system. So that is a way of using education to rebuild the intelligentsia in the region is by using a building a quality education system and not waiting for the central government to do something about it. That would be mine. I mean, you know, I'm an educator. I've been teaching for 12 years, so I am biased towards that. That's kind of how I would view the problem is through this prism. I know people who are in education right now in Slovakia and what they're doing, and they're working very hard to even get to a place where we are now, where there's 300 to 400 children enrolled in some form of Rusyn language instruction. 300 to 400 children. Now, thanks to only a handful of very committed individuals, we are at this stage. But it's unsustainable for future for Rusyn language and culture to survive. So I'm thinking what needs to happen is build a robust system which attracts parents themselves, where they can see the value in it, that they're going to get a really good quality education, better than they would in just a regular Slovak school.
Do you think that there needs to be a boosted business profile of Rusyn regions for this to really take effect? Because I have one kind of thought about this, and that when you originally came to me about the school idea, and even now, I think it's a really great idea. I think it's probably one of the best ideas I've heard about Rusyns in Slovakia probably ever. One thing I was thinking about, though, after our last conversation is that, so it will certainly solve our education problem. My only fear, or perhaps I think that it's kind of like one good part of a map, but it's not the full thing, is that we can have these great schools and these people will be educated and they may know Rusyn. This will kind of raise the kind of prestige. However, if we don't have the economic backing for these people to actually stay within the community, I mean, most of them, especially, I mean, they're going to, you know, they're going to leave to Bratislava, Košice. I mean, they're going to leave, as most of the young people who have some advanced skills already do. So my thought is that I'm not necessarily, you know, this is kind of a loaded question, because it's, I'm not trying to displace the accomplishment that would be. I'm just kind of interested in to see how you would want to perhaps intertwine kind of this, I shouldn't say renewed economic, you know, activity, because the Presov region has never been really, you know, that way. But I'm kind of interested to hear your thoughts on how we could also bring some economic opportunity with this and kind of complete the both of these points, so our people don't leave with an even better education.
Right. That is probably the big side effect given the economics of the region right now, that you would just give all the young people great education, they would leave and never come back, right? So that is something that needs to be addressed, and that's a very good question. It is a question that I, at this point, I really don't have a good answer. I mean, I hear a lot from the region, okay, so we had a bit of industry back in communism, so now how about we try to do some tourism, because it's pretty nature and so forth. And I'm thinking, okay, tourism industry is not something that most people would want to do, to serve other people and in a way where other people actually write a good review and want to come back.
I
don't think that people that spread this kind of these kind of ideas, they realize that, you know, whenever I'm sitting in a certain establishment back home and getting the death stares from a waitress because I ordered something that she's not used to, I'm thinking, yeah, probably tourism is not the kind of industry that's going to take off anytime soon. U.S. U.S. is when it comes to customer service, United States is like the pinnacle. So I can compare it against something. These people that they've never been much outside their towns, they think that's normal, you know. So,
well, let me tell you, that's just you guys, honestly. When I went to Transcarpathia, those people were so nice. When I go to Presov, when I go to what town was that? Humene? The amount of there's only one friendly guy in any of the restaurants that I went there, and he was this Turkish guy. Everyone else acted as though I was some alien. And so I totally get what you're saying. I mean I'm against, you know, mass tourism on principle for different reasons, but I mean, I definitely get what you're saying, and that, I mean, there needs to be some other solution than just some touring companies, you know?
Yeah, and tourism could be a nice side gig for some local business people. It could be something nice on the side, but it's not going to solve the problems. I think the best way would be to, I don't think a solution is to bring back large factories. I don't think so. Who's going to work in them? You know, there's this nostalgia for 1980s and 70s when these big factories opened up in my town and a lot of people had work. I mean, it was nice that, you know, it was first time in history where the people didn't have to travel out to earn some money. It was nice. However, you got to be realistic. I mean, young people now with college degrees, unless they're engineers and they're working with robotics and stuff like that, where it might be something interesting and engaging and meaningful for them, they're not going to sit behind a conveyor belt screwing on some bolts or something like that. You know, it's not going to happen.
but like what percent of the Rusyn youth is college educated? I mean, that is also my question too, of that, you know, I've heard something like that before, but you know, even in the US, I don't think even half of all Zoomers or millennials even have a degree. I may be wrong on that, but it's kind of a thing of where I don't think factories are the right solution either. But I also think that if we go kind of the very venture capital kind of high profession route, there needs to be this kind of combined industry. It's almost almost want to make it be more self-sufficient in all aspects.
Sure. Right. Of course, it can't be just those high-end jobs. There's for instance, there's a factory in my town. They have this a water cannon which cuts different materials. And my friend, he's an engineer and he works with that. He basically designs things, and then the cannon does its own thing. Yeah. Now that's one job that requires an engineering degree and so forth. But there's other jobs around it within the factory that don't, you know. So it's like its own ecosystem. So it employs people with higher education, like my friend, and people without higher education, like the people that my friend then argues with about Russia and Ukraine war. Yeah.
Well, one separate thing, because I really like what we're talking about now, but this really shocked me when I went there. So for everyone who doesn't know, you know, if you read RLS, you probably will, but I went to Ukraine and Slovakia and Hungary about 2 months ago. I used to write a story up on the war, and it was peculiar in many ways in regards to Rusyns, in that when I was in Transcarpathia, people perhaps aren't necessarily openly Rusyn, or they can't be, you know, they're not recognized. And yet I saw this liveliness, I saw this energy of activism, of this type of just desire to kind of break free of these kind of chains that's been put on them. And when I went over to Slovakia, the Presov region, number one, I was not impressed by Presov, the city. The church was, I mean, not the church. The theater was nice, though. The Duke Novich Theater. But there was this kind of, it just wasn't the same energy. It was quite dulled from, and I met quite a few Rusyns there, and they told me much the same thing, is that there's not this type of dualist energy. And I think this has applied very well to RLS as an organization too, in that for many of our writers, whether it be columnists or just guest authors, will, from my experience over 2 years, Transcarpathians, these people pop up just out of the woodwork randomly and write these beautiful things. And then, you know, they go off to do other things. But it's this thing of where there's just, it's almost like every month we find some new Transcarpathian who wants to write something or is really interested in contributing. A lot of our, the majority of our columnists are that. And then in terms of Slovak Rusyns, we pretty much had no interest, frankly. Mm-hmm. Lemkos were even better. Way better than Slovak Rusyns. And it just seems as though, I'm just gonna be honest, it seems like they don't really care about Transcarpathians or any of the kind of things that we've been doing at RLS in general. I think, you know, I think you may be the only one who's written for us. So
I think there is a certain sense of complacency. I would agree with that. Maybe we just had it much better than everybody else. And so people just grow comfortable with what they got, with and you know, not much attempts at doing anything more. Well, there are, of course, there are activists that are working very hard, and maybe too hard, in fact, and so that they don't have enough time to really create connections outside of their niches, you know. So. Yeah, I know some people like that. And
Medved is pretty connected, but he's always busy. So I wouldn't count him as one of those.
Right. So it's that issue. It's that activism is very It's very a shallow pond, but these people they are involved in it. They're working quite hard, and my attempts of doing the education is to bring in some new faces. So I'm trying to get people that are not at all involved in Rusyn activism and bring them in, and try to get something going through that. Yeah. So I remember watching an interview with one Rusyn from, I think it's from Stara Ljubovnja, it's way in the west. And he was saying that one problem is that we don't have professional organizations which would actually pay a regular salary to activists to do their jobs, because this is a job. It's, and right now people just do this on their free time. It's very rare to find someone who actually makes a living doing that. So yeah, that would be a good solution, but we're not there yet.
I'm kind of interested to hear your opinion on this. Do you feel as though there's this kind of missing middle area in a lot of areas of Rusyn society, and that you have a large population of people who are very undereducated about Rusyn stuff, and you have many scholars and very serious activists, and yet you don't necessarily see any middle ground in that regard, where perhaps they're not some type of highly educated person, but they're working well on like the local level to achieve something, or you know, they may be really proud to be Rusyn, but they're not even necessarily an activist. I feel like this middle position in many Rusyn societies, my experience is just more specifically from the diaspora, which is much different, of course. But I'm wondering if you feel the same way about the homeland in that regard.
Yeah, I think there is a shortage. And one way to bridge this gap would be if people are aware enough about their Rusyn-ness and willing to preserve that, so that they speak to their kids in Rusyn. If we can achieve that, and whether it's in all Rusyn marriages or mixed marriages, but the Rusyn people speaking Rusyn to their children. If we can achieve that, I think that would be like saying that they're in that middle area, right? Where they are aware enough, and it's not just folk costumes and singing, but it's also the living language and the contemporary culture as it exists right now. So that would be a huge achievement. And it's actually something that I'm thinking about right now, ways to achieve, is to contribute to raising awareness in people that Rusyn language has a value. Like the blog that I'm writing right now, I actually finished and I'm going to publish it soon in Slovak. And it's about how Rusyn has helped me to learn Chinese. Now you think, you know, these two languages obviously are so different. How can that ever happen? What is the value of Rusyn? Well, Rusyn can help you learn Chinese because there's certain, Rusyn is very phonemically very diverse language. And because of that diversity, it has some elements that you can find in different languages, and Chinese is one of them. Chinese has these semi-palatalized consonants, which foreigners, all of them get wrong, but if you're a native Rusyn speaker, you can pick that up instantly, and you can get it right away. Yeah, you can hear it and you can produce it right away because you have that in your native language. You have similar sounds, so there is value in Rusyn language. There is value in teaching more languages to people, and Rusyn is a language system within itself. So that is something that we need to get into people's minds, because you know, they're very much kind of, they live in these hills and mountains, and they got their horizons obscured. They can't see past them. So we need to, you know, break those mountains down so that they can see that there's a whole wide landscape. The world is big, and even a language like Rusyn has a value, and they should be proud of that, and they should teach that to their kids. That's what I tend to do as well with my kids. Is I will be speaking in Rusyn, and my wife will be speaking in Chinese, in Mandarin, and eventually they'll pick up Slovak as well and English as well. So that's a person can learn more than one language in a lifetime. It's not a problem. Yeah, it's in fact, in today's world, it's how can you get by with knowing just one language?
Going back to your article, because we've kind of strayed from it quite a bit, I had an inkling that you were perhaps somewhat pessimistic in general about the Rusyn future, in that you're doing lots of work to change that. However, to bring up one specific point from it, tell me if I'm wrong, but to me it felt very much that you were saying in the piece that many of these so-called victories in which our organizations kind of espouse as monumental things, like, for example, the total Rusyn population and the census, increased, and in these other such things. Do you feel as though these are mostly window dressing from the real situation? Do you feel that Rusyns in general are on the decline in terms of cultural significance, can we say, or perhaps kind of as an ethnicity in general? I know we kind of talked about this earlier, but I kind of want to more go from the angle of that. I see a lot in our organizations and our kind of press, if you can call it that, that people have this narrative going of that since 1991, everything's been going up from here. Mm-hmm. Constantly been improving every single decade. What I took from it was that this is kind of a happy falsehood in which people are kind of lulling themselves into and being distracted from the true reality.
I think just going back to this last census in Slovakia and saying that it's 60,000 and it's up, and look at all 100 new villages that will get the dual language sign because of the new census. I think it's a spin on the situation, but it is a necessary spin because you're fighting for limited resources, and so now you got more people, so you should get more money for your organizations, right? So it is a necessary thing to do that. So I'm not at all saying that you shouldn't say that. No, you should, but at the same time, you should address the real issues and real problems. And the problem is, you look at how many people actually signed the Rusyn language as their native language, and that's that number has gone down pretty drastically. So that is an important issue. I know a lot of families that are either Rusyn or that don't live in a Rusyn environment, or even live in Rusyn environment, or mixed families, and they're speaking to their kids in Slovak. And it's one of the studies that I quoted in the piece that said that 50% of families over the last 20 or 30 years, Rusyn has disappeared in 50%. Take another 20 or 30 years, it's going to be 50%. And so within a generation, we're going to be at a point of no return. And we're going to basically go extinct. And there's not going to be a way to revive this. I mean, we're not going to go the Hebrew way. There's not going to be a Zion, Rusyn Zion, where people are going to revive this language 200 years from now. It's not going to happen. So right now, we are on a knife's edge, and we need a lot more people to get involved in it, to also talk about the positives and whatever you need to get your money, to get your resources. But also, we need to be a little bit more alarmist about the situation as well.
Do you think some of it has to do with a lack of vision? I find myself wondering sometimes of that many other peoples and nations perhaps have their own national psyche, shall we say,
yeah,
in that Rusyns, yeah, feel as though they have none.
It's not just, I feel like this whole Western hemisphere has an embarrassment of riches when it comes to lack of visions. You know, it's just EU, like, has no real vision, it's kind of just floating on whatever, you know, just dealing with whatever the new crisis is, but not really plowing towards any kind of common goals, visions, and similar throughout other European societies and down to our very own Rusyn community. It is a lack of vision. One thing that I find hopeful, and you talked about how the Rusyns in Ukraine are, how they are just, there's so much activity going on. That's actually kind of my hope as well, is Slovaks had done good amount of work in the past, and there's some results out of that, and maybe the engine of change can come from further east for the next 20 or 30 years. I would be happy to see that, and I would be happy to see more interactions. Like, I noticed Mihal, he posted a video with Lemko from US. What is his name?
Marco.
And yeah, I watched the video, and it appears that the guy is from a village just north of Čertižne. He mentioned Jasliska, and that's right by where my great grandfather is from. So maybe we're even related. Yeah. So I think that could help. And also, I'm thinking at the people, the young people in the diaspora, if one way what can do, they can start also with a certain community building of their own. I mean, I would be very happy to see people who have the means to buy up a property in the Carpathians and create something as well, you know, to spend, commit at least part of a year, at least a short part of a year, to spending time in a homeland and doing something like that, you know, so something on the ground. That would be nice to see. If different communities actually interacting more like that. I mean, I liked that video. I was watching two Rusyns from very different necks of the woods talking to each other in Rusyn. That was awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, I certainly agree with that. Do you have any final things to say to the audience?
To Rusyn diaspora, I would just say, buy a house in the Carpathians. It's a buyer's market right now. And spend some time living there. To get a sense for your homeland. Especially if you have a remote job and you can swing that, that's very good. You can do that. So that will be something I'd like to see more of. I mean, it's nice to have a community like that, and to do that. I see myself in the future as being located somewhere in or near my hometown. Yeah, so at least part of a year. I've already caught the travel bug, so I don't think I can stay there for years on end. I don't think I can do that, but at least to stay there for much of the year, and if we can pull off good education reforms, and I won't be afraid to put my kids in those schools, and also longer, you know.
Yeah, I really appreciate you coming on. It's been wonderful to talk to you again. And
disconnect.
No, it's all good. Hopefully, your words and writings give more Rusyns inspiration. They have at least to one person. So thanks everyone for watching, and I'll see you next week.